thank you very much to all of you for staying or coming for this panel. My name is Julia Fromholtz. I'm the director of the Rule of Law and Governance Program at ASU Law School, and am located, my office is here in the New America building, and the program was co-developed with the McCain Institute. So I'm very grateful to all three hosts of this conference. And I'd like to welcome the audience here, and I think there's an audience watching in Arizona. So welcome to the audience in Arizona as well. First of all, I have to say that we are down a panelist, unfortunately. Nancy O'Kale from the Tahrir Center, Tahrir Institute for Middle East Policy, fell ill, unfortunately. So we'll hear more about Turkey and Pakistan today, and unfortunately not about Egypt. We've had great discussions today about counterterrorism policies in the U.S. and the rule of law in the United States. And this discussion is, we're going to turn the lens a bit. Instead of talking about the terrorism policies in the U.S. from the U.S. perspective and the rule of law here, we're going to talk about countries where terrorism is a more acute threat than it is in the United States, and where the counterterrorism policies of the United States have had a significant impact on counterterrorism and on rule of law. So we'll focus particularly on the effects of these policies on the rule of law in these countries. Earlier today, we heard about the use of force overseas and about the light footprint that President Obama has used and the fact that Americans are desensitized to some of the effects of our counterterrorism policies. We are lucky enough today to have two speakers who are from countries where people are not at all desensitized and where the footprint does not seem light. I would like to welcome Raza Rumi to my left, who is a scholar in residence at the School of Humanities and Sciences at Ithaca College. He's a consulting editor at the Friday Times, which is a weekly journal in Pakistan, and was an analyst and talk show host in Pakistan until he moved to the US following an assassination attempt in 2014, which killed his driver. And Dr. Aykan Erdemir is a senior fellow at the Foundation for the Defense of Democracies and a faculty member at Bill Kent University's Department of Political Science and Public Administration. From 2011 to 2015, he was a member of the Turkish Parliament and has been here since February. So many thanks to both of you. I've been very excited about hosting, about moderating this panel, because I'm so curious to hear what you both have to say. And to give you just a little bit of background, I spent 2 years in Pakistan working for the U.S. Embassy there, working on rule of law issues, I've long wanted to meet Raza. So thank you very much to both of you. And Raza, I'll turn to you to kick this off.
Thank you. I was here in the morning as well. And, it's always good to sort of flip the coin and see how counterterrorism is perceived and actually, implemented. And of course, I come from a country which has been a huge victim of terror and extremist violence. More than 60,000 Pakistanis have died in the last decade or so, including 5,000 security personnel. And from, bombs and suicide bombers roaming around in markets, in schools, in colleges, in hospitals. I mean, no area of Pakistani life, public life, has been sort of excluded from that, horrific unfolding of violence within our society. And of course, there is a whole war of narratives within Pakistan as well, alongside the actual physical violence. I mean, there is one school of thought which says that Pakistan was a relatively peaceful place before 9/11 and before the US attempted to actually invaded Afghanistan. And the other school of thought says, no, the extremist groups like the Taliban, other jihadist groups existed in Pakistan, and Pakistan used them as a tool of foreign policy, both in Afghanistan and India, to maximize its leverage and power. So, the country and the sort of national narrative has been wavering between these two poles of thinking. But since 2014, since we had a huge massacre in a Peshawar school where 140 kids and teachers were killed, there has been a shift in public opinion, at least, and within the military of doing something, because earlier, I think Pakistan's security establishment sort of tolerated the existence of many groups, such as the Pakistani branch of Taliban. The Afghan Taliban are still very much there and very much supported by us. But the Pakistani Taliban, which had turned against the Pakistani state and people, so the military started a very major operation. It is a huge counterterrorism operation, which has been ongoing since June of 2014, and by which some level of calm has come back. 50% of terrorist incidents have gone down. But the interesting part of that operation is that a lot of kind of legalese and policy discourse that the US uses for counterterrorism has filtered down into Pakistan as well. So whether it has to do with the targeted killings, whether it has to do with airstrikes over Pakistani people, you know, it's being done. So Pakistanis really objected to drone strikes by the US. You know, according to New America figures, there have been more than 400 drone strikes in the last 12 years, killing anywhere from between 200 to 350 civilians in those strikes. But other accounts say that this number could be much higher. It could be around 999, the Bureau of Investigative Journalism says so. And but the ironic thing is that Pakistan has also used the Chinese drones to take out some of the quote-unquote terrorists. And similarly, some of the air, fighter jets given by the US to Pakistan military have also been used in the northwestern part to you know, get rid of the terrorist groups. So it is this, I think, at a much broader level in the post 9/11 world that we now live in, you know, this whole discourse on terrorism and the kind of legal, you know, semantics used by the states have converged. And it's not just limited to Pakistan. I'll give you within South Asia, for example, in Bangladesh, we've seen in the recent year or so rise in violence against bloggers and journalists and atheists and secularists, etc. And a lot of language that is being used by the Bangladeshi government is also this post 9/11 US counterterrorism language, and often which sanctions and which enables the state to crack down on its political opposition, on journalists. Bangladeshi jails are full of opposition party members, and all being done in the name of countering terrorism. If you look at in India, where there's a, you know, long-standing dispute between Pakistan and India over the state of Jammu and Kashmir, and both countries have gone to war thrice again. So you see that particular idea of fighting these, you know, terrorism and terrorists. And I'm not denying that Pakistan has not in the past supported or still supports some of those militant groups and separatists. Pakistan does. But it is the kind of language and the methods that the state adopts. See, that they are very heavy-handed. They often are oblivious to the imperatives of human rights, of the guarantees enshrined in the national constitutions. And in Pakistan as well, you know, they have been forced disappearances. There have been many other brutal and heavy-handed tactics employed, and all in the name of national security, and which renders, you know, the entire constitutional and legal rights framework kind of meaningless. And it's all, and the greatest justification for that is that, look, the US does it, so we can do it as well. And the US, therefore, is kind of a trendsetter, unfortunately, which is something of a worry in this particular domain. I'll stop there.
Thank you very much. Icon.
All right. Let me try by the simple question, why should we care about Turkey? It's a country of 80 million, the second largest army in NATO, so a NATO member, together with Albania, the only majority Muslim members of NATO, an EU accession country, and if I know it's a long shot and it's a Hail Mary shot, but if it works, Turkey would be not only the largest but also the only majority Muslim member of the European Union. And moreover, Turkey is already in the EU in the sense that there are more than 3 million people of Turkish background, either as citizens of EU countries or residents of EU countries. Plus, Turkey is now hosting 2.7 million Syrian refugees, so it's a key partner in dealing with the humanitarian crisis in Syria, which means it's a country we have to care about, whether we like it or not. Now, let's come to the U.S. end, because in the Q&A we'll go into the details of the Turkish affairs, but I would like to make this relevant to an American audience, and the question is, U.S. counterterrorism policy, what's the view from Turkey? What impact does it have? Now, my first comment is, it's all about perceptions. It doesn't really matter what you do or don't do. It doesn't matter what the actual result on the ground is. Because when we take a look at from the 80 million populous Turkey to US counterterrorism policies, it's always about perceptions. And it's never direct perceptions, because there are cultural barriers, there are linguistic barriers, there are political barriers. So U.S. counterterrorism policy will always be mediated through cultural brokers, through intermediaries. So it's either people like me who will tell Turkish audiences, the Senate, the House of Rep, the White House, State Department, all the internal debate, you know, the reversals. Or it can be, let's say, a firebrand preacher saying, the great Satan will destroy our country together with Israel. So it will always be different versions of the truth. Now, and the selective perception, which is also all about selective portrayal of US counterterrorism policy, revolves around spins and around spin masters. Now, what are some of the key spin masters of U.S. counterterrorism policy in Turkey? Whether they're accurate or not, it's up for you to decide. One, of course, is this broad spectrum of Islamists. There will be different brands of Islamists who will portray U.S. counterterrorism policy through the worst cases and use it as a propaganda tool, use it as a recruitment tool. Second, you might be having cordial relations with Vietnam, but for Turkey, Vietnam War is still going on. So we have a very strong, what I call the 68ers. And I'm not just talking about the demographic category. I'm talking about 18-year-olds who are very much the product of 68ers. That is Turkey's socialist, Turkey's anti-American, very strong anti-American culture, particularly strong in the left. So they'll also perceive U.S. counterterrorism policies in this very negative light, no matter what. The third is, of course, social media. A lot of Turkish citizens will get bits and pieces, videos and sound bites and photos. Fabricated, accurate, doesn't matter. But people will have access to U.S. counterterrorism policies through social media. But overall, there is one thing that combines all different perceptions and portrayals. And I would argue that's Turkey's national culture of conspiracies. Turks love conspiracies. Turks are one of the most conspiratorial, maybe next to Pakistan.
We'll beat you anytime. Yes.
So it'll be like India-Pakistan cricket game when it comes to Turkey-Pakistan conspiracy game. But conspiracy will be the rule of the game. Now, why should this be of importance to a U.S. audience? Because ultimately, for example, Turkey's European Union accession is often about best practices, about converging to those best practices. When it comes to U.S. counterterrorism policy, it's about worst practices. It's how local brokers, it's how local entrepreneurs, political entrepreneurs, will find the worst practices of U.S. counterterrorism policy to legitimize their own breach of rule of law and undermining of due process and democratic process and transparency and accountability back at home. So no matter what you do, we will cherry pick, we'll find worst practices, and those worst practices will be our key tool of legitimation. And we'll use it as a carte blanche to, for example, as we do today, declare state of emergency, suspend European Convention on Human Rights, undermine rule of law, due process, detain people without access to an attorney for now up to 30 days, and so on and so forth. So we will legitimize, as Turks, our extrajudicial and extraterritorial acts by blaming it on the Americans, saying, see, they're doing it in these cases, so we can do it back at home. Moreover, we'll also use it to strengthen authoritarianism and one-man rule. You know, we'll, I know U.S. presidential system is nothing like what's happening in Turkey, which is de jure a parliamentary system, but de facto a one-man rule, one man who is trying to push the system toward an executive presidential system. But again, U.S. Worst practices will be the legitimizing tool. Now, what's missing from this portrayal, and I think this is something you have to really think about, is what are the legal and political challenges in U.S., such as maybe this event itself, to U.S. counterterrorism policy? What are some of the reversals? Because it's never linear in U.S. You know, you have wins and losses. You have challenges. You have checks and balances. You have the judiciary. You have the media. You have the nonprofits. You have activists. So I would argue this gets missing. To me, this is very much a core narrative of the U.S. experience, a core aspect of the U.S. experience, but your average Turk will never get to hear about that. A Turk might hear about the abuses and torture by Americans in an Iraqi prison. Turks will hear about Gitmo. Turks might hear about drone strikes, but Turks will never hear about the other side, which could be, in fact, very informative and inspiring for Turks. So my question is, counterterrorism policy, when it's done right, I see it as a public good. I know it's controversial to call it as such, meaning counterterrorism policy that within the rule of law, that deals effectively with terrorism and extremism, delivers benefits to a wide range of actors and countries and nation states. And of course, there are always free riders. The question is the US public diplomacy doing its rightful share of responsibility in portraying or communicating the untold parts of the story? Meaning, I'm not talking about whitewashing a breach of human rights. I'm talking about what parts of US counterterrorism policy, those parts that you see as success, and also those processes within US, you know, challenges, legal, political challenges, reversals, social activism, would you like to communicate to others as an inspiration, as a best practice to counterbalance the worst practices? So let me try to conclude for now by saying that from the Turkish perspective, US counterterrorism policy is often used and abused to deepen our culture of impunity, to undermine Turkey's rule of law and due process, again, to strengthen authoritarianism and one-man rule. And it's always a key ingredient in Turkey's scapegoating strategies. You know, we love lumping together. You know, we were just talking about how India, Israel, and US are always the key kind of suspects in Pakistan.
Unholy Trinity.
Unholy Trinity. In the Turkish case, there will always be US, strange enough, Germany, and of course, Israel. Now, Turkey has a normalization process with Israel, so the pro-government media is downplaying that aspect, but I'm sure it will make a comeback. So it always does. So we have our own unholy trinity. So now, let me end with a caveat then. First of all, those in Turkey who complain about, let's say, the shortcomings or the abuses of the US counterterrorism policy, trust me, they use the same tactics, and they'll abuse it even to a greater extent. So there's nothing genuine about the criticism. It's just a propaganda tool. Second, all of these preceded 9/11. So please don't attribute to yourself a great causal role in the way in which things happen in the world. Whether or not there was no 9/11, no subsequent US counterterrorism policy, we have already perfected back at home the art of torture, extrajudicial executions and disappearances, cross-border operations, often with civilian casualties, breach of rule of law and due process, long, and when I say long, up to 10 years of pretrial detention. Sure, our Islamists or our socialists or our conspiratorial-minded loonies could point the finger to the US, but after all, probably even before you could start to imagine some of these tactics in response to 9/11, I'm pretty sure both in Pakistan and in Turkey, we were quite an expert in the ways in which we were tormenting our own citizens across the board. And the conspiracy theories and the scapegoating were all already there. Sure, post 9/11, we added another chapter to our book of conspiracies, but the volume was there. It was whatever, a 12-volume encyclopedia. And post 9/11 counterterrorism policies is just an addendum. So that's my kind of a little pessimistic and and cynical take on the issue, but we'll go more into the detail with the Q&As. Yeah.
Thanks to both of you. I will start off with some questions and then open it up to the audience. Icon finished with something that was my first question, so I'll ask it of Raza, whether U.S. policy after 9/11 or since 9/11 led to a change in course, or was the country on this trajectory anyway, this using the counterterrorism narrative to stifle legitimate opposition, to repress, to not adhere to the rule of law. And I guess I'll also ask you, Icon, adding to the end of what you said, has the fact that U.S. counterterrorism policy since 9/11 has engaged in some of these, has engaged in torture and some other acts that I think Americans would say are not of their values, has that changed anything for the opposition in Turkey, for people who are trying to enforce or promote the rule of law?
Yeah, I think it did. You know, the U.S. Sort of intervention in Afghanistan and Pakistan's decision to ally with the United States obviously altered the course, because prior to that, as we know, Taliban were ruling Afghanistan. Pakistan had backed them. Pakistan was comfortable because, you see, the problem that we have, and that is the complexity of the local situation, which often gets lost in the policy making process in Washington, is the fact that, you know, Pakistan's objectives in that region are linked to India. So it did not want India to have any influence in Afghanistan in the first place. So it kept on supporting the Mujahideen first, and then the Taliban government. And then 9/11 was a very difficult moment, because here General Musharraf had to, when President Bush told him either you are with us or against us, so he had to take one side, and obviously he had to be with the US. So there was little room for wiggle there. But once he did that, so then Pakistan moved away from that official policy and was in a kind of an existential dilemma as to how to deal with all these Mujahideen since the Soviet anti-Soviet war in Afghanistan, and what to do with these groups. So so initially, Pakistan did try to rein them in, you know, and but the problem was that all of the Taliban fighters and the leaders and different tiers, they started pouring into Pakistan, and particularly into the Pakistan sort of tribal areas, which unfortunately are also kept semi-governed or totally, I mean, to be precise, ungoverned, because there are no modern institutions, there are no courts, there's no police, there's no proper rule of law in that area. So it's since the time of the British Empire in India, that was a kind of an open space and a legally opaque zone. And so it suited both Pakistan's strategic ends, as well as perhaps the Taliban leadership to be in that zone somewhere. And that led to, a lot of pressure within Pakistan and within the growth of this militancy. And then, as we know, the Al-Qaeda also moved after Afghanistan was being heavily bombed. And in that particular time, Al-Qaeda also had not just bin Laden. I mean, bin Laden is the face or the symbolic aspect, but the Al-Qaeda as a network moved into Pakistan, and then they made alliances with local militant groups which had existed pre 9/11, and that turned into by middle of 2005-2006, it was a major challenge for Pakistan, and that's when the incidents in terrorism started growing huge. And then there was this, as was very eloquently put, by the perception issue as well, because you see, there was an element within Pakistani state which was not very happy with the idea of abandoning the Taliban, whom we had nurtured or entered into alliances. So they kept on using the worst practices, the bombings on hospitals or the civilian casualties, etc., by the United States as an excuse to delegitimize the whole thing. And then there was a very popular narrative saying this is not our war, i.e. the counterterrorism war. It's an America, it's an American-led war. It's America's war. Why should we hurt in the crossfire? So I think that's that kind of complexity in the U.S. counterterrorism policy is often overlooked. I'll quickly conclude. I know I'm taking more time than perhaps you have envisioned for me in this question, but look at the Iraq policy, for example. I mean, now everybody, there's a consensus here in the US that Iraq was wrong. Even Mr. Trump doesn't want to acknowledge that he supported the Iraq war. So bad it is. The New York Times, which kind of fully supported, go ahead and bomb Iraq because they have weapons of mass destruction, has also apologized, okay? And the unintended consequences of that war and that invasion, not just that there was a sectarian genie came out of the bottle in Iraq, and which led to, events led to the formation of ISIS, which is now a new, I'm sure the next administration will be dealing how to deal with ISIS. First it was how to deal with Al-Qaeda, first it was how to deal with the Soviets. So there's a constant, either it is that there are gaps in the policy-making process which overlook the local complexities, and what has happened with the invasion of Iraq, that Iran's influence has quadrupled perhaps, if not more. Now Iran has another country under its sphere of influence. And I know that in DC, and because I was here for a year with different think tanks, that there are lots of Iran phobes. And the question is that on the one hand, there is this whole narrative about Iran, this evil theocratic government with making nukes. And on the other hand, they are being supported by US's own policy. So I think those particular gaps and the oversimplification of the local context is perhaps a key challenge to the counterterrorism trajectory. And I think that's where in Pakistan, for example, people say, and particularly when US wants to invest in the rule of law programs in Afghanistan as well, and a lot of local people ask, well, is the US adhering to rule of law itself, the kind of rule of law it wants to build in our countries? So that's an often question raised in the local media. And I think that particular gap, again, has to do with perceptions. It's overtaken by the loonies. And that also needs to be managed alongside some very hardcore decisions that the US policy industry makes.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Ikan?
I wonder which part of that question shall I focus on. But now, I guess US policy, as I said, even before 9/11, at Turkish politicians, radicals, terrorists, arsenal, we had a wide range of discursive tools available to propagate, legitimize, their ideas, as well as to recruit militants. So U.S. policy, post 9/11 policy, hasn't necessarily been decisive in that regard. But in terms of opposition capabilities, I think it has had an impact, like a greater impact. That is, what have you lost, either as democratically minded opposition parties or as activists, NGO activists, is that, first of all, losing what I would roughly call the moral high ground of transatlantic values. Now I know in this realist age, there is little room for values, but I argue that values are a very effective weapon. Again, sorry for putting it that way, but I sincerely believe in it. And when you undermine the moral high ground of rule of law, due process, pluralism, democracy, you know, inclusiveness, transparency, accountability, all the set of values that I would argue set our transatlantic alliance apart from others, then it's a tough job, first of all. And second, you know, especially for those of us who have always tried to argue with Turkish people that NATO is not just a military alliance, it's first and foremost a political alliance. It's not an alliance of tanks and fighter jets, it's an alliance of values. And when you lose that on both ends, meaning on the Turkish end and also on the NATO end, through short-sightedness, through introversion, through lethargy, same with the European Union. The European Union and its acquis communautaire and its Copenhagen criteria, as well as the Council of Europe and its European Court of Human Rights and the European Convention on Human Rights, all of these have been and could have continued to be important resources for opposition, for citizens, for activists, to strengthen the rule of law, first of all. Second, to improve the ways in which citizens are incorporated, are included in the polity. And thereby, I would argue, undermine a lot of the terrorist recruitment tools have been eroding. We're losing these tools. We're losing these opportunities. We're losing the efficacy of these values. And I think that has been a key challenge, because the moment we start criticizing, let's say, Turkish government abuse of rights and breach of rights and freedoms, they'll immediately will find a worse practice, either from the US or from the EU. And interestingly enough, they'll never find it from China or Russia. They'll always find, and in fact, in China and Russia, they can easily find even the worst practices. But no, they will always find that one French practice, that one British practice, that one US practice, which could be temporary, it doesn't matter. But it will have this magic effect of shutting the opposition up. And I think that's something we have to think about, meaning when in the West we take extraordinary measures. Of course, there's always the question of efficacy, you know, does it really deliver results? And the second question is, by undermining our own moral high ground and by undermining our own transatlantic values, and I know in this, you know, multicultural age, one can see this to be quite ethnocentric, and one can say that, oh, it's all relative, and you know, we should drop this reference to transatlantic values. But hey, coming from Turkey, from the very east of this alliance, you know what this is? The culmination of thousands of years of human struggle, intellectual endeavor. And I'm sorry, I'm not willing to drop human rights, free markets, democracy, transparency, accountability, and so on and so forth. You can find billions of demagogues from Turkey to China who will tell you that, oh, it's all relative. I've heard officials tell me, human rights, you know, even the concept of human is different in our country than the West. You know, people will argue ad nauseum about how everything is relative and there can be no values. I'm sorry, I don't get it. Neither do the religious minorities I advocate for get it, nor the LGBTQ community, nor Turkey's Kurds, nor Turkey's urban poor. Guess what? People who are on the suffering end of this, they get transatlantic values very well. They know what they want. They know they want rights and freedoms. They know that the English word human rights is the exact same word insan hakları in Turkish. And to them, there is no cultural relativism. Sure, if you're a member of the Communist Party in China, if you are a member of President Erdogan's inner core in Turkey, yes, cultural relativism will be extremely attractive. But for the people who have been losing their lives and livelihoods and their languages and culture and religious freedoms, we have one set of what I would consider positive set of rights and freedoms and values. And it's very important to cherish it in the countries where those ideas have flourished for hundreds of years.
Indeed, thank you. So on a related topic, oftentimes when the US government is pushed to speak out in favor of human rights and the rule of law to authoritarian governments that are close partners in counterterrorism, the reaction is, well, we can't do that because then the country will turn to China and Pakistan's all-weather friend, or to Russia in the case of Turkey, or to others. What's your reaction to that? Would it actually have a positive effect? I'm not optimistic that a new U.S. The next U.S. president will do this strongly, but what would your reaction be, or what would your recommendation be on that front?
You want me
sure.
to?
Yes, okay. Please.
Well, I mean, I'll limit the response to the context of Pakistan, although I have other ideas too. But I mean, the problem again, you know, and sadly, is with the kind of way the US security interests have always overlooked the inner dynamics of a country. So take the case of Pakistan. All three military dictators were frontline allies of the US government in the 1960s when there was a Cold War going on, so Pakistan was again in the alliance. Then came the 1980s when the Soviets had to be driven out of Afghanistan. We had the worst dictator in Pakistan who Islamized the country, who abused human rights, who passed these medieval barbaric laws, but he was a US ally until he died in a plane crash. And then came Musharraf moment and the war on terror. So I think a key problem there has been that, I suppose, when it comes to kind of formulation of security policy, I mean, and fair enough, I don't blame the US for that, because I mean, if they have to go and get something done, they better get it done from the institution that delivers. But it has harmful long-term effects. So in the case of Pakistan, democratization, you know, whatever has happened in the domestic sense, but I think with the US support to these military regimes, brutal military regimes, has had a very adverse impact on the trajectory of the country. And I think for the next administration, coming back to the last part of your question, I think that is an imperative. And I think if it is Secretary Clinton who's going to win, she understands Pakistan very well, and she also knows the value, and she tried very hard as Secretary of State to support the civilian government in Pakistan and push the limits of civilian assistance. And I think that is what perhaps would be of a more durable, it is more painful, it is long-term, it does not show immediate results, but that is the kind of support that I would think should be forthcoming from the US. I mean, you know, this over-reliance on the military aid, over-reliance on the short-term security goals has not really led to a kind of a society or a country that perhaps can be peace with itself and with its neighbors. And I think investments in civil society, in education, I think one of the greatest examples of a good thing that the US did, and there was a very small grant, I think $10 million in the 80s, to Pakistan's best known private university in Lahore now, and the seed money went from the US. Nobody really talks about it. You know, we hear about F-16s and this jet and that bomb and this daisy cutter or not, and you don't actually think of the long-term impact that university has had on Pakistan, which actually came through with US support. And I think it's those kind of investments which would be far more helpful. And related to this, I think there's also a lesson for the counterterrorism policies of the US in the last 16 years. I mean, has the Al-Qaeda been defeated? Well, yes and no. It has been defeated in point A, but has moved to C, D, E. Has Islamic extremism been wiped off from the planet of, no. It has re-emerged in the form of new avatars, okay? Has the Middle East stabilized? Well, not really. So I think there are a couple of lessons to be learned here. And I think the key lesson is that knee-jerk, ill-designed military campaigns are no alternative to long-term partnerships and investments with Muslim societies and with the civil society therein. You know, you have people like Icahn, and you know, there are thousands and millions like him in the so-called Muslim world. And those are the kind of alliances that the US needs to forge. But unfortunately, what we are seeing here, I mean, since I'm here, so, you know, the kind of xenophobia and Islamophobia that is being drummed by a certain political party and its campaign and its campaign is actually going to be damaging to the US counterterrorism efforts. You know, let me be very clear. So it is not as simple. I mean, I know it sounds funny for sound bites and social media clickbaits that Mr. Trump said this or Y, Z, but in effect, all of those things are used by the terrorist recruiters. You know, the statements against Muslims, or whether it is about, you know, hint of a war crime, is actually a very, very clever ploy, and it is used by the jihadists and the other extremist groups to get more people under the jihad belt. So I think it's an ideological issue, and as put by Icahn on the transatlantic, or whatever you want to call it, post-enlightenment, post-Renaissance values, whatever term you want to use it, I think that is where it is that kind of a battle that needs to be supported, where you have reformist Muslims and reformist groups, and where you have a kind of a transatlantic core of a values. I think that is where partnerships need to evolve to better fight terror, and of course within a very robust rule of law framework. You can't be violating rule of law and preaching it in some other countries.
Thank you.
Now, let me start with my own bias. I always preach against appeasement. It's my Chamberlain complex. So my first rule of thumb for the next president would be, do not appease. Now, I understand that this doesn't mean disengage, but we have to realize that there are other ways of engaging than appeasing. And I would argue most of the bilateral relations so far revolved around some sort of appeasement. And I would argue that it has made things worse. You know, I understand your question. It's an important question, meaning if you don't appease Turkey, could it drift toward Russia? Could it drift toward Eurasian Alliance, what Erdogan calls it, you know, Shanghai Cooperation Organization? But I would argue, paradoxically, that it's because the US has appeased Turkey, not Turkey, but Erdogan, that actually Turkey drifted away from the NATO and the EU. It's because the EU and the US have failed to engage, have failed to build a principled engagement with Turkey early on, that we are now in this mess. And we see NATO's kind of, you know, southeast flank country drifting away. You know, Turkey tried to procure a Chinese missile system, and now it's trying to procure a Russian kind of long-range air to, you know, a surface-to-air missile system. And of course, and Turkey has plans to plug it into the NATO mainframe, you know, possibly leaking all sorts of NATO secrets to China or Russia. And of course, these are issues we should be concerned about. But these are problems not of year 2016 or 2014. These were disasters in the making. You know, it was clear that I'm talking about a lot of missed windows of opportunities, whether it's Turkey's EU membership process, which could have been handled much differently, or whether Turkey's descent into authoritarianism, which could have been dealt very differently, or whether it was the US's naive assumption that kind of a moderately Islamist populist government could be the formula for transition to some sort of democracy in the region. So I would argue that when we take a look at concrete examples, we see that appeasement rarely works in the Middle East. And often, countries that manage to get their relations back on track are countries that have what I call a Bronx attitude, a tough attitude. Just to give you an example, after Turkey's July 15th abortive coup attempt, President Erdogan met President Putin in St. Petersburg. And Erdogan addressed his counterpart, with whom he was on the verge of a war until 2 months before that meeting. He called him, in an almost archaic Ottoman, embellished Turkish, my very dear friend Putin. Now, how did that love affair, how that bromance came about? Because Putin has been treating him horribly, threatening him with use of force, bringing his armies. He showed him that he too is a thug and is willing to engage. So respect is very important, I would argue, in the Middle East. That is, this tough attitude, meaning this engagement, whether we like the attitude or not, it means something. Same with Turkish-Israeli relations. Since the flotilla event, there has been horrible rhetoric on both sides, very tough posturing on both sides, which allowed normalization. Please check Turkey's pro-government media today. There is not a word against Israel or Russia. Please check Turkey's pro-government media today. Every single day, there are smear campaigns against the US and the EU, because Turkish government has zero respect for the European Union and the United States. Why? Those are the two entities that feel that they have to appease Turkey. We will force you to appease us, but if you fall into the trap of appeasing us, we will hate you. We will not respect you, and we will trash you. But if you treat us like Putin did, with, you know, planes and missiles and proxy wars and really strong language, we'll address you, my very dear friend Putin. I know it's very strange posturing. It's very difficult to get. But ultimately, we have to realize that we have members of this transatlantic community that have diametrically opposite communicative strategies. And I think mastering those strategies should be key to the next US president's way of dealing with these, what I would call, idiosyncratic leaders and political cultures.
So we need to be thugs who care about rule of law. Exactly. With that, I will open it up to questions from the audience. I see one in the back on the aisle.
When talking about how counterterrorism efforts can affect the local communities, as we see a shift towards counterterrorism efforts taking place within the US to combat nationalist terrorism like we saw in Kansas this past week, how do you think that this will change counterterrorism policies when they're being executed against US citizens who the Bill of Rights and our full Constitution applies to?
I'm sorry, I don't... it was a little bit hard to hear you. Yeah, can you say it again? And specifically, I got the sense that you're asking a domestic U.S. question, which I don't know if these speakers are...
When talking about how counterterrorism policies can affect a local population, when we move that now back to the U.S. In the wake of recent developments with domestic terror, do you think that the way that counterterrorism affects the local population will change within the United States when we're working with U.S. citizens who have a full Constitution and Bill of Rights on their side?
If you feel equipped to answer having a quick thought
on that, I don't really have an answer, but maybe this. I guess for the cultural brokers that I mentioned, people who take a look at what's happening in the U.S. and who then portray it to their own society for political gain, this will just give them yet another opportunity to tell, see, even in the U.S., when there is such a threat, even if it's not from Muslims, and even if it's coming from white Christians, and that's the only categories Turks would know, see, they're still tough, which means we also have a right to be tough on our own citizens, Turkish or Kurdish, Muslim or non-Muslim. It doesn't make a difference. So I think probably most people will miss it altogether. There will be very little traction back in Turkey concerning what's going on with, let's say, homegrown U.S. terrorism. But my assumption is the few cultural brokers who are interested in using that as an opportunity to make a point at home will probably use it for the most part to simply back up kind of all sorts of tough action against citizens back at home.
Do you want to?
Yeah, okay. I mean, I agree with Aykana here, and I think that's the kind of, you know, in the sort of game of perceptions, it does leave a very sort of big question mark. In particular, the police violence, police-related violence in the U.S. is already being cited in a lot of countries with all these shootings and of unarmed young African Americans. And I think that's always used by a lot of opponents of the U.S. saying, well, you know, in your domestic arena, you can't really ensure justice. What are you telling us about justice and law?
Saw a question in the blue shirt right on the aisle. Yeah.
Hi, Kevin Meister, currently intern at Human Rights First. I have a question on Turkey. How do local populations perceive the fact that it's providing logistical support in the fight against ISIS? And second, how do you think the recent coup attempt has impacted U.S.-Turkey relations? Because I know there were some conspirational accusations about how the U.S. may have been involved.
They believe in it. It's not a conspiracy.
Turkey's support for, let's call it jihadism, is Islamist radicals across the board. There are two takes on it. One is, this is a new game for the Turkish government, meaning Turkey is located in a part of the world where there are other regimes with great expertise in state sponsoring of terrorism, as well as proxy wars. And Turkey, for good or bad, until quite recently, were illiterate in these affairs, meaning Turkey has no real experience with fighting proxy wars, unlike Iran or Syria, and had very little experience with sponsoring of, let's say, terrorists or, you know, radicals, you know, violent extremists. Syria changed all that. You know, Turkish government, Turkey's Islamist-rooted Justice and Development Party, had the mistaken assumption that there can be quick regime change in Syria. And they also had the mistaken assumption that with a little backing to jihadists of different sorts, including al-Nusra Front, some other al-Qaeda affiliates, maybe some ISIS militants, they thought maybe the Assad regime could be gone. And we know for a fact that they had 3 months of a calendar in mind. So this is how ill-informed they were. And they thought, after 3 months, a lesson they didn't learn from Pakistan, which they should have, they thought they could push the button, stop jihadi violence, and hand power over to Muslim Brotherhood in Syria. None of that was accurate, and it failed miserably. And so today, Turkey is left with what we call Pakistanization. That is, Turkey tries to disengage, in fact, even fight some of these jihadi forces. We warned them when I was in parliament. We kept on warning them when I was in parliament. I've pushed for Turkey to designate El-Nusra Front as a terrorist organization. Ultimately, Turkey came there, but it was too late, meaning Turkey is beyond the point of no return. So the damage has already been done. So at the state level, our engagement with jihadis of different sorts was a huge mistake, and it will continue to haunt us in the decades to come. But then there's a second aspect to it, and that is citizens are extremely tactical when it comes to extremism. For example, for most of Turkey's ethnic Turkish citizens, if you put ISIS, if you juxtapose ISIS and the PKK, Turkey's Kurdish separatist organization, they'll say, you know what, let the ISIS kill the Kurds. So people are extremely pragmatic. And this pragmatism is not just at the level of, let's say, citizens, but also even at the level of, I would argue, political elite. So there is that problem there. Now, coming back to your second question about, very quickly, Turkish-US relations. I know this sounds like a new episode of Star Wars, but it's a saga. Basically, two-thirds of Turks believe that single-handedly a religious community called the Gülen community, headed by a reclusive cleric in self-exile, self-imposed exile in Pennsylvania, masterminded the coup. This was also carried out in collaboration with the CIA and the Americans. And this was part of a global conspiracy to undermine Turkey, because Turkey is rising up in the world to be the leader of the Islamic world. And this is an attempt to prevent the return of our Caliph Sultan.
Sounds familiar.
Yes, sounds familiar. Now, of course, like every other conspiracy theory, there are bits and pieces that are accurate and bits and pieces that are exaggerated. That is, sure, when we take a look at the coup attempt, among the coup plotters, there were significant numbers of either members or sympathizers of the Gülen community. But we also know that there were people, coup plotters, who had nothing or little to do with the community. So still, we don't fully know the full extent of the factions that came together before and during the coup. But I would argue today, Turkish public has very little appetite for this very complex question. I call it a dirty family secret, meaning we all know, I think, by this point, that if we really have a serious inquiry into the coup attempt, very ugly details about our very private affairs, including our military, our secret service, our parliament, our political parties, our bureaucrats, they'll spill. And we don't want this dirty laundry. And we have a very convenient truth. That is, why don't we take one of the key cores of the coup plotters, that is the Gülen community, and conveniently, all across the board, a lot of Turks hate the Gülen community because they were victimized, or they believe they were victimized by the Gülen community early on. Kurds, Turkish nationalists, Turkish secularists, and former allies, Erdogan supporters. So they all believe, you know what, we all hate the Gülen community, and they have grievances. So they say, why don't we just put all the blame on the Gülen community, which saves us from the problem of dealing with the other aspects of the coup. For example, it's very rare for people like me who are of secular background to say that, wait a minute, sure, the Gülen community is implicated in the coup, but this is not the first coup we've had. We had 60, the failed 62, 63, 1970, 80, 71, 80, 97, 2007. So it's a long history of coups. And I would like to say, wait a minute, don't we have to think about Turkey's military culture? Don't we need to think about civilian-military relations? Don't we need to think about impunity, culture of impunity? Very few, if ever, of the officers who succeeded or failed in a coup have ever appeared in, before a court of law in Turkey or have been jailed in Turkey. So to me, there are these other issues which we should discuss alongside which factions were behind the coup, but we don't, which means because we won't talk about the real issues around military coups over the last 56 years, we will talk about the US and the CIA, and we will talk about only one of the factions of the coup. I know it's a very complicated topic, but this was the shortest and the fastest way to make it intelligible. So if we talk about the US, you can take it simply as our attempt to avoid talking about painful issues. We don't want to talk about it, and we won't talk about it. So we'll point the finger to you.
Here in front.
No, I just want to add that, you know, you talked about discourses. So Gulen is in Turkish official media is labeled as a terrorist. And the Gulenists are terrorists. So it's the post-9/11.
Yes. Interestingly enough, when the Gulen community was on good terms with Erdogan, yes, as key allies, yes, and when they were very influential in the judiciary and the police and going after the secular military, they also arrested the former chief of staff, can you imagine, as a terrorist. So it's a common Turkish tactic. We will, if we want to get rid of you, we will find a pretense to frame you as a terrorist. You can be a cleric, you can be a chief of staff, yeah, you can be the president of the leader of the pro-Kurdish party. We will find a way to frame you as a terrorist, and we'll go after you with a vengeance, knowing pretty well that in a decade or so the tables will be turned and you'll come after me with the same tactics. Yeah. But I guess it's a pendulum.
Thank you so much for speaking with us. It's an incredibly interesting discussion. I was particularly...
I should ask, can you identify yourself?
Oh, sorry. My name is Ann Peacock. I work at the Department of State. I'm curious in terms of your recommendations for the next incoming administration on other ways of engaging and the non-appease, that we should not appease. Specifically toward that question, I wanted to understand more what you thought your role of regional multilateral institutions like the Council of Europe, which houses, you know, shared normative frameworks on human rights, democracy, rule of law, and which Turkey is a member of, you know, what is the perception of the Council of Europe in Turkey? And how are these recent trips by the Secretary General, the Venice Commission, the Human Rights Commissioner of this institution, you know, what could potentially be the benefits of those trips if used appropriately by the international community? And, you know, following that, you know, is the U.S. utilizing these institutions in a constructive way? To that end. Thank you so much.
Again, let me start with my bias. I'm a true believer in these multilateral and some of them supranational institutions. I used to serve in the Turkey-European Union Joint Parliamentary Committee, and in the meetings I used to joke that I'm the last Euro-federalist, including all the members of the European Parliament in the room, because everyone has given up on the European ideal. I haven't. I'm still a true believer in Euro-federalism, and I think we're not really using the opportunities provided by these. Now, the question is, of course, I think the U.S. is underutilizing it, in fact, or utilizing it even in an extremely limited way. So there is a great ocean of opportunities out there. I know with each day that passes, each day that these institutions undermine themselves, whether it's the Brexit, whether it's Eurosceptic Europeans, or whether it's, I guess, institutions that don't enforce their own decisions, the room for maneuver narrows. But still, there is so much, I think, room for action, although it's shrinking. And again, on a skeptical note, I remember a talk by a professor of international relations back in Turkey, and I realized he confused Council of Europe with the European Council of the European Union, which also should be a caveat for us, meaning for those of us who are very engaged with these institutions, they are a great resource. Not only those, even, for example, for someone like me who have done a lot of advocacy work for religious minorities, each time the United States Commission on International Religious Freedom releases its annual report, I would find it as a great resource and I would use it for my advocacy work back at home. So people who, for the small minority of people who are very interested in these institutions and in their outputs, sure, they're a great resource. But at the same time, the caveat is this. There are also a lot of other people. There are millions of others who don't even know the difference. They can be professors, but who don't even know the, or who can get confused about the difference between these institutions. So I think that maybe a key challenge is this. How do we make sure, first of all, how do we make sure that we use the potential that's out there as policymakers, as, let's say, State Department officials? Second, how do we find user-friendly ways of making these things intelligible? Venice Commission, you know, immediately to me it makes a lot of sense because I see it as a key resource for discussing Turkey's next constitution, for discussing Turkey's world record bearing 10% electoral threshold, for parliamentary immunity issue. But Venice Commission, if you just say it out loud, 75 million Turks out of 80 million will think we're trying to sell them a tour to Italy. So the question is, what are some of the key communicative strategies we have to find? And I think this is not just the PR aspect that I'm talking about, because ultimately I think we are failing often at the level of strategic communication. That's why one of the reasons why I refer to public diplomacy. I think there's a lot of room for action and improvement in terms of public diplomacy and strategic communication. And one best practice I can recommend is authoritarian dictators. They are masterminds of strategic communication and public diplomacy because a lot of the horrible corruption, breach of rights and freedoms, disrespect for others. What keeps that system going? I think very able, capable spinning and manipulation.
Propaganda.
And propaganda. I know we don't call it propaganda in our part of the world, but
let's say.
Hence, I think we have something to learn from them. I'm not saying using those vile tactics, but I'm saying we can't just say that, you know what, our content is good. Let the people understand why it's good. No, we have to make them intelligible. And when I say make them intelligible, in Turkey, I'm talking about a population, half of which is under 30. So we have to find a young medium, a young parlance, a population that has on the average 6.5 years of schooling. So we have to, quote unquote, dumb it down so that a country of 80 million with 6.5 years of average schooling can get it. Third, often a monolingual society. You know, people who are not well-versed in other languages. Not only languages, but who are not well-versed in multiculturalism, in pluralism. Again, making it culturally appropriate. How can we get this message across? And I think it takes a lot of creative work.
Question all the way in the back.
Hi, my name is Andrea Hall. I'm with the Charity and Security Network. When we talk about local effects of counterterrorism policy, we need to mention the fact that the material support statute and other aspects of U.S. counterterrorism laws and policies restrain the ability of nonprofits to work in terrorist-controlled areas overseas. And this, in turn, creates a humanitarian vacuum. It restrains the ability of peace-building groups to go into these areas. And the irony is that that in turn creates an environment ripe for terrorist recruitment. I was wondering if any of you would want to comment on this apparent irony and how you think this might play out in the next administration.
I'll actually add something to that. I know in Pakistan, and I'm less familiar in Turkey, there's an NGO law that's been quite controversial among the diplomatic community because it has been used to throw out at least one humanitarian group and has been seen as a way, as NGO laws in a lot of countries are, to reduce the space for opposition, for NGOs, for civil society organizations. So not just because of material support, but because of an NGO law. And I think that the Turkish government has been rather effective in shutting down the space for NGOs and opposition voices to be heard. So maybe add that to the question.
Yeah, I think about the irony, of course, I mean, I agree with you. It's a kind of a vicious cycle. But on Pakistan's humanitarian law, I mean, you know, there is paranoia within Pakistani state that a lot of NGOs are actually working for foreign intelligence agencies. And we used to sort of counter that as a propaganda again. But partly, unfortunately, the US also gave a very good reason for the Pakistani media and the state in the form of using a nonprofit to go and collect blood samples, DNA for DNA verification of bin Laden and his family in Abbottabad in Pakistan. And for many, so there was a big crisis because then that NGO had to shut down, its staff was left, and it had an adverse impact on other foreign nonprofits as well, and continues. You know, that's a very tricky legacy, unfortunately. And I think that, again, takes us back to the issue of transparency and the issue of how these operations and how these strategies are carved out and how unthinking they are at times, because they put at risk not just the lives and the operations of US or Western-based charities or NGOs, but they also create the kind of conditions that was highlighted by you. Yeah.
And they also, in the Pakistan case, put at risk public health, because that's one of the reasons that polio has become endemic there.
Correct.
Because the Pakistani people, who are nurses and doctors who are going out to immunize people in the tribal areas, have been shot.
Yes.
Have been attacked by terrorists because of this.
Yeah,
at least that's the reason that's given.
Yeah, the Taliban banned polio immunization for a long time, which led to a resurgence of the virus after we had sort of tackled it. And now it has taken last 4-5 years of very hard work to overcome that. And part of it was linked to that they were thinking that a lot of these immunization or health workers were actually, you know, spies.
Right.
In disguise.
Let me try to think out loud about this. I think what we are seeing increasingly in the Middle East is failed states or semi-failed states, which then lead to territories not receiving state services, which then leaves room for, on the one hand, extremists to either deliver services or control territories, and on the other hand, NGOs to try to alleviate the humanitarian crisis. Now, it seems there are always double standards on the state side. For example, when we take a look at Syria and Iraq, sure, there will be certain, for example, Turkish state-sanctioned NGOs that will be seen as doing some proxy work for Turkey, who will be funded, encouraged, facilitated for their work across the border in these, let's say, failed state areas. But then there will be other NGOs, often independent, often dissident-run, often focusing on areas, whether it's Kurdish rights, whether it's women's rights, whether it's LGBTQ rights, or whether it's, let's say, a secular non-Islamist NGO, which will be subject to restrictions. And when I say restrictions, it's not just, you know, travel or transfer of funds or delivery of services, but even in, for example, in the case of Turkey, concerning the Kurdish enclave Rojava, a lot of the Turkish activists, and some of them are not just, you know, peaceful activists, but also people taking up arms against ISIS. If and when they die, they have a huge problem repatriating the body back to Turkey. So now there is a category of Turkish citizens who have died across the border, let's say doing nonprofit work, but I'm defining nonprofit in a very general way here. It could mean someone fighting against ISIS, mm-hmm. out of solidarity with Kurds, mm-hmm. to someone delivering healthcare to children. They might end up getting stuck at the border zone. There was a body that was repatriated with the family only after 60 days because the Turkish state blocked the re-entry of this deceased person's body. So again, coming back to my double standards issue, states can be either enabling or restricting NGO work in these territories. And often there are security considerations or strategic considerations attached to them. But ultimately, I think the effect is it makes things more tricky for NGOs and NGO work. As Raza said, one part of the difficulty around the NGO work is all these, as we see in Russia, in Pakistan, mm-hmm. in Turkey, all these associations. You know, the NGOs are a fifth column. Yeah. In Turkey, it would be US, yes. or Germany, to begin with, maybe Britain. So key suspects would be these. But at the same time, because NGOs are now increasingly part of the proxy wars and proxy state involvement in these failed state territories, beyond the, let's say, the pre-9/11 mm. neo-colonial, neo-imperial conspiratorial fantasies, there are now new sets of paranoias or suspicions attached to the NGOs. So I guess things are getting more difficult than ever.
Yes, but I would just quickly add that there's a problem with INGOs as well, and we again have to move back to the framework of accountability and transparency. A lot of INGOs do not often make their operations and accounts transparent to the host governments. So I think there's a bit of a problem there too.
Thank you. And we have time for one last question. Someone over here. The mic is coming.
Hi, my name is Nihal Krishna. I'm a political reporter in town with Circa News. So my question is, both, you know, Islam is one of the major religions in both Turkey and Pakistan, and I'm with a number of terrorist organizations supposedly affiliated with Islam in the past 10 or 15 years conducting terror strikes. I'm curious to know what your thoughts are on how Muslim communities are accepted in other parts of the world, in Asia, Europe, and America, and whether there exists sincere forms of Islamophobia or not, and particularly contrasting potential Islamophobia in Asia to Europe to America.
Does either of you feel equipped to answer? That's a bit off topic, but if you want to answer it.
I mean, do you want? I mean, I can just say I don't know about Europe. I have, but I mean, I've been here for the last 2 years, and I do think that a lot of Islamophobia has been generated in part by the political discourse and in part by the mainstream media. And I think they are, mainstream media plays a very toxic role in that, unfortunately. But the good thing is that the independent media kind of offsets in the United States, and the mainstream media's labeling, its inquiry, its headlines, its emphasis. So for instance, you know, about 100 people, I mean, for every American who has died at at the hands of Islamic terror or terror since 9/11, 100 people have died due to gun violence. But this sort of emphasis is missing. What terrorism gets the headline, terrorism gets the in-depth focus, but the key large elephant in the room, which has to do with guns, and even Secretary Clinton's prescription of handling that is very problematic, because if you can't fly on the planes, you must not hold guns. I mean, who doesn't fly on the planes? I mean, take a wild guess, you know? So obviously it's a Muslim name, which would be stopped or checked for security since 9/11. I mean, others are not really under that much scrutiny. So I think there is a whole systemic sort of effort and that, and unfortunately it is again linked to the set of counterterrorism policies and the diagnosis that goes along with that. I'm not denying that there are very dangerous violent extremist groups in the Middle East, in Pakistan and Afghanistan, and in other parts, who recruit people who believe in a transnational, poisonous ideology. But the mothership of all of that is a country that is still an ally of the US, which is known as Saudi Arabia. And Wahhabism cult and its toxic ideology is what informs all these radicals. And guess what? Saudis are still getting billions of dollars of arms from the US to bomb kids in Yemen. The Saudis have still not been held to account for their state or private complicity in 9/11, for instance. And guess what? Afghanistan and Iraq have been punished for Saudi ideology. That's how I view it. And I think that so it is all kind of the way it's perceived. It's very skin deep. It's very partial. And I hope that after this political campaign is over, the temperatures go down and Islamophobia sort of will come to kind of an auto normal levels. But certainly it's not just the US. In Europe, it's even worse with the kind of narratives we see. And I used to be a very vocal critic of Islamic extremism, but in these 2 years, I just feel that, oh my God, the moment you open your mouth about Islamic extremists, it's going to be played up by the whole Islamophobia industry. And so one has to completely position oneself in this different context. And I think it is a disservice. I mean, at the end of the day, the total population of the United States is barely 1% of the total. And the paranoia is maybe 300%.
Now, as someone who pushed very hard for Turkey to pass a hate crimes bill, and we're still not there, we have a half-baked bill at this point. Let me put it this way. Sure, there is Islamophobia, not only in, let's say, in the non-Muslim world, but also even in parts of the Muslim world too. I've seen a lot of Islamophobic Muslims myself. The second question, a lot of the people who talk about Islamophobia in a very self-righteous way, a lot of the Muslims who talk about it, it's shocking to see that they don't at all think about or work around issues of anti-Christian sentiment and anti-Semitism. So this is not to legitimize hate. I've devoted my life to fighting hate crimes and hate speech, but if you ask me, would you rather like to be a Muslim in US or in the EU, or a Christian or a Jew in Turkey or Pakistan, I'll take the EU or the US anytime and every time. Is it easier to build a mosque in the EU or US, or to build a church or a synagogue in Pakistan or in Turkey? So I think one way to make progress on these issues is to make sure that we're not too particularistic, and we approach the issue of hate crimes and hate speech as a whole, push a holistic agenda. That is, for example, I'll be attending, funny that you asked it today, I'll be attending an Islamophobia event tomorrow, which will be funded by a Turkish institution. Now, I doubt other Turkish institutions will be too happy to fund an event back at home about anti-Semitism or the ongoing persecution of Christians in Turkey. So let me end with a maybe heartwarming anecdote. You remember the case of this, I think, evangelical pastor who wanted to burn a Quran. And then actually, you know what, it was, again, a friend of mine, a devout kind of Christian clergyman who went there and who prevented it. It wasn't police, it wasn't the White House. It was basically community intervention. It was kind of Good Samaritans intervening. And this made it to news, I think, on CNN. And then people, if I'm not mistaken, in Pakistan were watching this. And they saw this act of kindness. And they managed to call a few people involved and told them, we saw this, we were very moved by it, and we adopted the local Christian church and community as the local Muslim community. And they went there, they cleaned the church, and it was almost like an informal form of protection. Just to show that often, these kind of more, I would call, humanistic and holistic kind of outreaches, and it's not a police outreach. It's it's not a military outreach, but it's
a humanistic. Kinda,
yes, it's
vision,
kind of a, but reciprocal, and not again, not cherry picking. It has more potential to deliver. Meaning, I think the best that Muslims can do today in the world to fight Islamophobia is not necessarily to hold Islamophobia events, maybe in Paris, in London, in DC, in New York, but they can maybe to treat Christians and Muslims as Christians and Jews and Hindus and atheists
respect,
better.
Yes, exactly.
And in fact, I'm sure that will have a broader impact because the best policy, going back to my anecdote, the best policy to protect Christians in Pakistan, in this case, was to look after your Muslim neighbors. Mm. For, that's why when I was in Boston over the summer, I saw a church with a huge banner downtown. It said, love your neighbor as yourself, but then before the neighbor, they put Muslim. So the church said, love your Muslim neighbor as you love yourself. So I tweeted this back home, because I knew this was the best move possible to protect Turkey's minorities. Because if one Muslim who's prone to violence against minorities saw that church in Boston embracing Muslims in the US, I'm sure it's more effective than putting an extra 10 Turkish police officers next to a synagogue or a church. So I think this could be my, I guess, idiosyncratic way of dealing with Islamophobia.
Great communication too.
Well, thank you, and I'm happy to end on that note that also espouses pluralism and American, what I think a lot of people want to see as American values, even if they're not always spoken about that way. So thank you very much to Icon and to Raza. And we have a very short coffee break until 2:45, so about 5 minutes, and then we'll start our last talk on endless war. Thank you.